If you asked 100 church leaders, what's the best way to attract new people to a church, the majority would answer personal invitations. And I agree. Knowing this, how can we inspire your congregation to take those steps and begin inviting their friends and family? Well, by the end of this video, you'll have your answer as we dive into what it takes to create a culture of invitation.
Well, hey there, and welcome to Pro Church Tools, the show to help you share the message of Jesus while we navigate the biggest communication shift in 500 years. I'm your host, Alex Mills, joined as always by Brady Shearer.
Saw a Facebook thread this week. The question that prompted the thread was simply put, what's the best way to attract new people to a church?
Billboards. Is that not it?
Nice. There were about 100 comments. 99 of those comments were billboards. No. The majority.
And the Lord left those 99.
Yes, I saw. Wow. The majority of the comments, it was a consensus reached. It wasn't close. Church leaders, pastors responding, saying the best way to attract new people to church is personal invitations. Yeah. From existing churchgoers, asking mm-hmm. and inviting their friends and family to come along church with them. Better than billboards, better sure. than Facebook ads, mm-hmm. better than mailers, better than any of these digital, traditional efforts. There's nothing quite like being personally invited through an existing relationship.
Yeah, which is interesting because we talk a lot about Facebook advertising. You know, this biggest communication shift in the last 500 years is the internet, right? That has enabled us to use Facebook to target the exact kind of people we want to target. And in this case, it's actually personal relationship. It's that one-to-one invitation, that face-to-face invitation often that just by consensus, like just supersedes every other option, Facebook ads included. And it's all built on relationship. There's a trust element involved here, especially with church, right? A lot of people are hesitant to either come to church for the first time or return to church if they've left, maybe because of a hurt or something else. So there needs to be trust, and I think that's why you see these personal one-on-one relationships really succeeding when it comes to inviting people to church.
And beyond the Facebook thread responses, we've actually got some data that supports this thesis as well. This comes from Dr. Tom Rayner from the Unchurched Next Door. It says 82% of the unchurched are at least somewhat likely to attend church if invited. It's more than 4 in 5. On the inverse, only 2% of church members invite an unchurched person to church. 98% never extend an invitation within a given year.
Wow.
Still more from Rayner. 7 out of 10 unchurched people have never been invited to church. 67% of Americans say a personal invitation from a family member would be very or somewhat effective in getting them to visit church. This is a different source. 63% say a personal invitation from a friend or neighbor would be very or somewhat effective. Is that the same stat twice?
It's super true then.
It's so true that I had to write it down twice.
Well, what this seems to suggest is that for a lot of the folks who aren't in church, they're just waiting for an invitation. And when they get one, what does it say? 4 to 5 of them are going to say yes.
Yeah, anywhere, there's different things, like anywhere between 3 and 4 and 4 to 5. The point is, based on the data that we have and all of the personal responses, the experiential data from all of those churches in the Facebook thread, here's the summary. Personal invitations, the best way to attract new people to church. Unchurched folk, very receptive
yeah.
to those invitations. It's all good, right? No, because most unchurched people have never been invited, and that's because most church goers are not doing the inviting.
98% of them.
It's a lot.
Yeah.
We're the only two.
No, you know what? This is one of those things, like as a pastor, I'm usually one of the people to prompt our congregation and saying, hey, you know, like bring someone to the church picnic or whatever. And then we have those services that I have encouraged our church people to invite people to. And I look around and they've done it. They brought a friend and I look beside me and it's always just my wife. Like I do a really bad job of inviting people to church.
But
so
if you hadn't have inspired them.
Well, maybe.
So by like, you know, through association.
No, I need to be better. I need to invite more people to church because the data suggests that most of them are going to say yes.
Well, and the unspoken thing here, this is why we talk so much about Facebook ads, about social, is that there's so much that your church can actively be doing, mm-hmm. but this thing that is so effective, proven to work, it doesn't rely on you. We're going to talk about the things that your church can do to inspire your congregation, the churchgoers, to take that next step.
Yeah.
But there's only so much that you can do. Mm-hmm. That's what kind of makes this a bit difficult for churches because they know like, okay, there's the most effective thing that we can do to attract new people to church, which is so important to us, but we have no control over it really, except for inspiring people to do it.
Right.
Of course, the inverse of that is that churches can sometimes kind of feel like, look, our job is to equip our saints and if they're not doing things the way they should, that's on them. And that can allow you to kind of just step back and say, we don't have any personal responsibility about reaching new people, which, you know, is probably too far in the other direction. Mm-hmm. We've got four things specifically that your church can do to create a culture of invitation that inspires your congregation to invite their friends and family to church. The first is that in every service, we talk about this a lot, you should acknowledge new people and set expectations for service. Mm-hmm. Why is this? Because I can hear some people thinking and saying, well, we don't really have any new people to come to our church. Yep. You know, we're like most churches, 100 or fewer in weekly attendance. Why are we going to be setting these expectations every single week and like saying, hey, welcome to all the new people? But it's like, they're not here.
Right.
I had this interaction on Facebook this week through one of our social posts with a guy named Mark McDonald. And he says, and I quote, we now say welcome to new people every Sunday, even if there are any new people, mm-hmm. and we outline the service expectations every Sunday as well. And I responded, hey, love it, Mark. That's great. But then he responded with something that really made me think. And I hadn't considered this before. He said, people invite friends when they know what they're inviting them to.
Yeah. There's that trust thing again, right?
Absolutely. Because the thing we don't really want to approach here, but it's true, is that if 98% or whatever the number is, if the vast majority of our congregation isn't willing to extend an invitation to a friend or family member to come to a service, the reason is not because they hate the Lord. It's probably because they don't feel like they want someone to come to church and see what it's really all about.
Well, there's a lot of, I was just going to say it, so I will say it, a lot of weird stuff that we do at church.
Facts.
If you're not a church person, right? So you come into church and all of a sudden we're singing about the blood and then, right? And then singing about being washed in the blood. And then there's a table with some bread and some wine on it and we're breaking it and drinking it.
The bread and the wine. There's this is more blood. Okay.
Yeah, exactly. What's going on here? And so if we're not creating this culture of always acknowledging the new folks in the room and maybe taking a moment to explain some of this stuff, your church members are likely thinking, well, I really want to invite Susan, but we don't really explain a lot of the stuff we do here on Sunday. So when Susan comes and we start singing about the blood, like, what is she going to think here? And so we've actually touched on this in previous episodes. Something that your pastor does really well at your church is if you come up to a word or a topic that is like very Christian-easy, he'll take the time to like pause and make sure to define it for everyone in the room. And that's a church of a few thousand. Now for us, some really practical tips, we're a church of about 100. And so we don't always have new folks in the room, but we do meet at the communion table every Sunday. And so every Sunday we have to explain that we practice an open table at our church. So whoever's serving communion will do the spiel and then they'll say, and here at Life Abundant Niagara, and then they explain that everyone's invited to the table. Same thing if I'm preaching. Every time that I get up to speak, even if I know there's nobody in the room, I start by saying, hey church, it's so good to see you. If you're new here, I'm Alexander. I'm one of your teaching pastors. Or if you don't know me, I'm Alexander. Even if I know there's nobody new in the room, instead of saying for all the new folks in the room, because that's awkward if there is nobody in the room, but it doesn't have to be awkward. You can just say, hey, I'm Alexander, one of your teaching pastors here, blah, blah, blah. So just setting those expectations and acknowledging those folks, even if they aren't there.
It's so easy to just simply say, hey, if you're new here today, that if clause means you're not like explicitly saying for all the new people if they're not there. And it also allows people to kind of opt in and say, I am new, even though it's their fourth or seventh visit, they still feel like they're being acknowledged, which is so important. And to be clear, there's a fine line, and it's not super easy to draw that line, but there's a fine line between changing your entire service structure and everything that you do as a church to make it more attractive to new people versus, at the very least, just explaining what's happening. So you might not feel comfortable like, well, you know, this is one of our favorite songs. We're not going to sing it just because it has like verbiage that's like going to be sounding weird. We're not going to like throw out communion. Obviously, you don't have to change anything. It's just a common courtesy. If you want new people to come, to explain what's going to be happening, right? Like when you go to a new restaurant, like, hey, have you been here before? Because let me explain the menu.
Yeah.
That's just a nice common courtesy. They're not changing the menu.
Yeah.
They're just saying, okay, we do it kind of a bit different here, and here's what to expect. And then once they've laid that out, you're like, great, I'm up for like trying something new.
Yeah.
And they've considered my perspective, and I'm ready to go from there.
Your worship leader could take 12 seconds in that Selah moment between songs and say, church, we're going to play one of our favorite songs next. And it's just kind of an acknowledgement that we believe that, you know, Jesus Christ died for our sins, and it's because of the power of that blood that we're free. Just, you know, just that definition of that song. So then when you start singing that song, the person who's new is like, oh, this is the blood we're singing about, and this is why, right?
Oh, this isn't a death cult.
Right, right. Yeah, we're not going to be drinking any red Kool-Aid here. Like, I'm safe.
No, it's grape juice. Yeah. Anyway, the thing that's happening under the surface here that Mark McDonald in this comment really brought to light for me is that there's one thing to do all of this acknowledgement and expectation setting. You're doing it for the person that may be new there. Mm-hmm. But perhaps even more importantly, you're doing it for the person that comes every single week. Because when they have the opportunity to invite someone to church, they're going to think about all the past weekends. And they'll think, if I bring someone, what's it going to be like? And if you have been for 8 weeks, for 800 weeks, being like, hey, if you're new here, they're going to be like, oh yeah, it gets totally common for new people to come.
Yeah.
They're going to feel considered. I know my senior leadership is considering them. It's not going to be awkward. It's not going to be one of those things where they look back and be like, hey, remember when you invited me to that really weird thing that affected our relationship forever? None of those things are going to happen. And so you're doing it for the future. You're laying the foundation for when it comes.
So good.
And before we can get even to these like next three things, I really want to highly encourage you as an individual who works or serves in a church to take an audit, take inventory, everything that you're doing, and say, what are we actively doing that is suppressing invitations? Hmm. What are we actively doing that is making people uncomfortable or unwilling to take that invitation? Hmm. Or maybe just hesitate. Maybe they're not unwilling, but just that second guess.
Yeah.
And there are some things that you're doing that you're like, okay, that's kind of core to the Christian faith. We're not going to change that. But could we make a tweak here?
Sure.
Could we make a tweak there? This is where you bring in a secret shopper. You ask people that you feel are going to be honest with you if you can ask. Mm-hmm. And then you adjust if you can.
Yeah, so good.
From there, it's time to equip your churchgoers with resources.
Yes.
Make it easy. Remove any existing barriers even beyond what your atmosphere is actually like on a week-to-week basis. So invite cards are one of the most obvious ways that you can do this. We've got a bunch of examples from that same Facebook thread. This first one comes from Grace Church. On one side, there's a big At the Movies sermon graphic. Mm-hmm. And on the other side is a little bit of information about this church. It says, hey, we've got awesome kids programs, we've got free coffee and pastries, casual environment, real answers from the Bible. There's a link to the website. They've got their logo, some pictures of the people that go to their church. Yeah. Oh, just a nice little postcard size, but you can also do it in a business card size.
Yeah.
We've got another invite card here that's like totally see-through, which is really cool. It's got the
really
service
cool.
times.
Yeah.
One has a big emoji. It's called Meet the Feels. I'm curious.
Yeah.
Any postcard with a giant emoji, that's gonna stop the scroll. When I was like choosing, because there were a bunch of invite cards in this thread, I was like, which ones do I want to use as examples in this episode? And I saw this one with a giant emoji on the front, and I was like, stop my scroll.
Yeah.
That's probably a good design point.
The business card size has really resonated with our congregation. I made a run of them last year. On the front, it just says, come as you are. And then on the back, it just has all of our service information. That's it. Link to the website. Super clear, super concise. And our congregation loves those things. Like, I could not print more fast enough. And you know who it was? It was the old ladies who were taking them. Like, Pastor Alexander, do you have any more of those cards? Like, I've been keeping them in my car and I ran out. So, like, I'm going to need some more. I'm like, I will print you some more, like, whatever you need. But those little business card size, so even if you have a stack, like, I keep a stack in my glove box in my car, like, they're non-intrusive. When you give them to someone, they can stash them in their wallet. They don't have to carry around, like, an 8x10 pamphlet. Perfect size.
If you are going to be designing these, the essentials that you want to make sure you include are your church's name.
Yep.
And logo, service times, super important, a link to the website, and hey, maybe even your slogan, or come as you are, something like that Alexander has on his churches. Now, another church took this even a step further with an entire invite booth, and they did this for Easter. So we've got pictures of it. If you're listening to this, you may want to watch, because I can only describe it so much, but it's kind of like, you know, think of like a lobby kiosk. It's this whole booth that says Easter Invite Central, I believe, and the explanation of this booth, in their words, is our desire is for everyone who calls CBC home to utilize the invite options we have. Do we have just, no cards? No, we got a lot more than that. We've got
Evites,
window decals, key tags, poster, and invite cards.
Wow.
So, you know, window decal,
decal.
America pronounces this different. We say decal and they say decal, I think.
I've always said decal.
I always thought decal was the Canadian pronunciation too, and Decal was American? Because decal just sounds like what America would say. They'd be like, we're too lazy. Like, decal.
Yeah, let's speed this up.
Decal.
Yeah.
About decal on your car.
Stop.
Sorry, America.
You can do that because my wife is Southern.
It's true. Hey, hey, see?
She did this to you.
See? Okay, that's all right. Yeah. Post in the comments. You can make fun of us. Tell us how it's actually pronounced.
Yeah.
And they also have these key tags with another word I had to use. Learn, a carabiner.
Carabiner.
I looked it up online. It
was carabiner.
Like, no, they said like carabiner.
Carabiner.
It's that little clasp that like you use if you're backpacking.
Oh.
Or you put on your keychain.
Right, right. Yeah. So what they say is like put a bunch of key tags on.
That's awesome.
And like you always have your keys with you. So you put your business cards in your car. What if you're not in your car? They're on your carabiner.
Carabiner.
Take them out. Hey, hey, why don't you... I want to learn about my friend named Jesus. Have you heard about my friend? Can I tell you about my best friend?
Well, let me tell you about his blood.
We are 8,000 people just unsubscribed, and I don't blame them. If you want to take a look at what these photos look like, make sure to watch the YouTube video. Mm-hmm. Thirdly, timely campaigns. So a lot of these invite cards, invite resources, they're kind of built around the two big events of the year, that being Easter and Christmas. But you can also do this during the summer. Usually summertime at church is a little more laid back and casual.
My third favorite Sunday, church picnic right after Christmas and Easter.
We'll get to that. But, you know, like maybe you have an at the movies.
Yes.
Regrettably, you have an at the movies series. You've got a Q&A. But you can also, doesn't have to be a service, like Alex just mentioned. You can do an event because we've talked about creating a casual or an atmosphere where churchgoers are comfortable with inviting people to church. You can do everything right. There's always going to be a certain percentage of people at your church that are just unwilling to invite their friends to a service.
Sure.
But they will be willing to invite them to a church event.
Oh, don't
and
we know that?
That can be the perfect on-ramp.
Mm-hmm.
Church picnic at Alex's church.
Yeah.
You can have something like a big summer bash. You could have a fall festival. Mm-hmm. You could have, you know, pictures with Santa during the Christmas season, something that's not quite a service. So I would recommend doing these invitation campaigns in spurts, not something that you're always hitting on.
Yeah.
You kind of burn out people where they're always feeling like, I got to invite people. Do it in like these sprints where people can get charged up. They can run and then they can recover and you can look forward to another sprint down the road. But again, don't limit yourself just to like Christmas and Easter, the obvious ones, but you can create something that's uniquely yours, especially considering, you know, church competition is a real thing, whether we want to like acknowledge it or not. Like everyone does this whole Easter and Christmas thing.
Mm-hmm.
So you can do something unique in the middle of February and run a campaign there.
Yeah, this is a great strategy too because it's timely as well. You know, like for our church, we have those little come as you are cards and those are evergreen. You can hand them out whenever, but that's an open invitation. It's like, come visit us at church whenever, any Sunday. But for these events, they're timely. It's like, no, a Christmas service is on December 24th. Like, come on December 24th. Or like, fall festival is next week. Come to church next week. And so maybe it just gives that person that you're inviting a little more incentive, like, okay, I know when I'm going to go. This festival is next week. They can kind of get themselves psyched up for it if they need to. And then, like you said, it's a perfect, it's like a gateway. It's like a bridge event, right? Like, you get someone to the church picnic. They see like, oh, these are real people. They're not singing about the blood here. And then next Sunday they come, we're singing about the blood, but they've already felt comfortable, so it's all good.
Got it. Final thing that you can do to create a culture of invitation is make sure that you're always communicating about it and highlighting when it goes well.
Hmm.
Because as much as you create resources, you create a great atmosphere, in my experience, there's always going to be kind of this like, little bit of suspicion and hesitation amongst your churchgoers. They're like, is this really going to work?
Right.
Is this really going to lead to something good? It's one thing to quote a stat from Rainer during an announcement.
Mm-hmm.
There's another to fully convince somebody that this is actually going to work for them with their friends and family. So when someone does invite a person to church and they end up getting baptized, make sure you highlight that story of life change. Do an announcement about it.
Yeah.
Create a whole testimony video about it and create this cycle of invitation. That's how the culture really is created, where you talk about it, you resource people,
mm-hmm.
it happens, and then you celebrate when it happens, which incentivizes more people to do it the next time you talk about it. And that's how the culture gets created. It needs to be this cycle that repeats over and over again. Your congregation might just be suspicious no matter what you do, no matter how you resource them. But when you tell a story of that person that they've seen at church, they're like, they got baptized. That was just from an invite?
Yeah.
Like, Jason just invited his friend and then he got baptized? Oh, that could be my friend.
Yeah, and it it's perfect because this is all about life change, right? This is not about more butts in seats. This is not about more dollars in your offering baskets. This is about the life-changing power of Jesus that we want to expose people to when we meet on Sundays or whenever you meet. And so when somebody sees a testimony at a baptism, when somebody's choosing to get baptized and you highlight the story, you go out of your way, why don't you tell us about the first time you came to church? And they say, well, actually, it was Kaylee over there who invited me. So someone else is sitting in the congregation saying, oh, like, look at this monumental moment, this life-change moment that I'm watching right now. It happened because Kaylee had the courage to invite them to church. Or let's say you do a testimony video. We've talked about doing testimony videos. I'm watching this video, I'm crying, and then it gets to the point where it's like, and I'm here because Brady invited me to church. It's like, oh my gosh, I have to invite that person I've been thinking about because this is the possibility. This is what could happen. So if you're not highlighting those things, your congregation could be even suspicious. You know, of course, Pastor Alexander's asked me to invite someone to church because we just want to fill up these seats. Well, no, that's not what it's about. It's about life change and in this life with Jesus. And so highlighting these life changes when they happen and saying, well, I'm here because someone invited me, that's going to really contribute to a culture of invitation in your church.
Four ways to create that culture. Number one, create a welcoming atmosphere where your congregation is comfortable inviting their friends mm-hmm. and family. Secondly, equip your congregation with resources. Maybe those are invite cards. Maybe it's a whole invite booth with some creative ways of inviting people. Number three, host timely campaigns, Christmas, Easter, but in the middle of summer. Maybe your church has a unique annual thing that you do every single year, mm-hmm. a fall festival or something different. And then finally, highlight the wins. Celebrate when these things work because that just encourages people all the more to continue doing it next time. And as a final thing, it's always great to communicate, hey, your first invitation might not work. That doesn't mean it won't work on the second time. Right. There's a rule in marketing called the rule of seven that basically it takes seven brand touches, whether that be a social media post that someone sees or a Facebook ad or mm-hmm. hey, even a billboard, who knows, before someone is like, okay, I'm ready to take a step with this company. It's the same with, you know, coming to church. Maybe it's even more than seven.
Yeah.
One
seven
invite
times
rate,
70 could be.
All right. That was actually pretty good. I like that one. That'll do it for this episode of Pro Church Tools. We'll see you next time.
That's all for this video, but there's going to be another one, so subscribe to make sure you don't miss it.
And before you go to the next one, you still have one more thing to do for this one. You got to tell us, did you like it or did you like it?